Chicago police may have passed over crucial clues in the mass murder investigation. Details on these stories and others next on Eyewitness News.
A $6 million lawsuit has been filed against mass murder suspect John Gacy. Parents of slain teenager John Butkovich hope to be awarded proceeds from any publications about the Gacy case. They also want any funds from the alleged killer's contracting firm. Tonight, Jay Levine continues his close-up look at the Gacy case and how police may have overlooked evidence that could have prevented the murder spree.
A careful examination of police and other official documents by Eyewitness News reveals that John Gacy came into contact with authorities more than half a dozen times, allegedly involved in crimes ranging from kidnapping to rape and assault. His name came up in connection with missing persons. He was even linked to a theft committed with the car of one of his victims. These police contacts came not with unrelated, relatively unsophisticated suburban departments, but with one of the biggest, best equipped, and trained departments in the world. Even so, using the same combination of bluff and bluster with which he talked his way into being photographed with dignitaries, Gacy managed to talk his way out of each and every beef. Said one former employee, he had a way of getting what he wanted. He was a master con man.
And he was good. I mean, he got whatever he wanted, you know. He did what he had to do to get what he wanted. That was his philosophy.
In August of 1975, Johnny Butkovich's car was found abandoned at Lawrence and Sheridan. The 18-year-old's jacket, wallet, and keys inside. The last time his parents saw him, he was leaving to confront John Gacy about some back pay.
And this youth police, he told me, he talked with the Gacy. Gacy refused to talk to him. And he should know right away, something wrong. If Gacy don't want to talk to him, something wrong right there.
Area 6 youth officers considered Butkovich a runaway. Youth Division officers from Areas 5 and 6 were out looking for John Gacy again 5 months later. Responding to reports of a man named John cruising the uptown area picking up young boys, they followed him for over a month, questioned youths going in and out of his Norwood Park Township home, and came up empty. Later that year, Taft High School senior Greg Godzik disappeared just after telling his girlfriend that 1976 had been the best year of his life. His mother told Area 5 youth officers to check out the man Greg had worked for, John Gacy, and then called Gacy herself.
I talked to him. I called him up to find out if my Gregory called. And he said he did, and that he was going to come to work. And I says, well, did he ever come? He says, no. And I says, how do you know it was Gregory? And he says, because he had him on his tape, you know. And I asked him if he could play it back. He said, no, he erased it, so I wouldn't know.
Did you ever tell the police about your conversation with John Gacy?
Yes, I'm sure I did.
Police would have had no way of tying Gacy to a 19-year-old who disappeared barely a month later, except we've learned that this time he got careless, taking and then selling John Szyc's 1971 Plymouth Satellite to Mike Rossi. Gacy and Rossi, other employees say, were like father and son. In December, Rossi was brought to the house on Summerdale to point out the location of holes he admitted digging in the crawl space. He claims to know nothing about the bodies. It was Rossi's failing to pay for a tank full of gas in September of 1977 that brought police to Gacy's home once again. He and Rossi straightened out the beef about the gas and in the process convinced police to close the Szyc missing person file. This letter was sent to Szyc's parents. Dear Mr. and Mrs. Szyc, I was unable to locate your son, but I did learn that he sold his auto in February of 1977 and told the buyer that he needed the money to leave town. But no one seems to be able to explain why, if Szyc needed money, he left behind two paychecks, all his possessions, and even bought new license plates for the car the day he disappeared. Had Chicago police bothered to check, as we did, the original title to Szyc's car, note the signature, and compared it to the title transfer filed when the car was allegedly sold by Szyc to Gacy and Rossi, again note Szyc's signature, it would have been obvious to them that something was fishy. John Szyc did not sign the second time, 18 days after he was reported missing. He was undoubtedly already dead. Area 6 homicide sex officers in the state's attorney's office also took Gacy's word against that of the teenager he allegedly abducted at gunpoint near Lawrence and Western in December. During that assault, the 19-year-old youth tells me, Gacy bragged of having killed others. He claims he told all this to police.
In light of
Jeff Rignall told a similar story 3 months later. He succeeded in having Gacy arrested last summer, But it was while that case was pending, Gacy free on bond, that Desplaines teenager Rob Piest disappeared and set in motion the chain of events that led to the gruesome discovery of bodies in Gacy's basement.
Police not does good job for my son, not for the rest of those kids. If they follow those thing, investigation, maybe Johnny only be dead. Only Johnny, maybe rest will be unalive. Rest of them have to be dead.
We requested an interview with Chicago Police Superintendent James O'Grady, a man who's known to be quite upset about police handling of the Gacy case. The request was denied. O'Grady said any comment on his part would be improper and in violation of a gag order imposed by a circuit court judge. In the meantime, we've also learned that three former Gacy associates are still under investigation for their involvement in or knowledge of the assaults and murders. One of them, Mike Rossi, will be ordered to hand over handwriting samples in connection with a forged title transfer. Rossi, sources say, has already hired former state's attorney Ed Hanrahan to represent him. Jay Levine, Channel 7 Eyewitness News.